Dies Lied ist aus der Sehnsucht süßer Sprache.
Come in.
Reporting for work, sir.
Relax, son. This isn't the academy.
Yes, sir.
And Mr. Sullivan will do just fine. I think you'll find that the COI is a bit more informal than your other branches of government. Now, let's set you to work. Some city detectives sent this complaint over to us. It should be pretty straightforward. If you have any questions about the assignment, don't hesitate to ask. The door's always open, son.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Sullivan.
What is it, Mr. Pearson? Oh, yes, of course, your office. It's across the hall. And please forgive the mess. Your predecessor departed rather unexpectedly, and we're still short-staffed and haven't had a chance to clear it out for you. Well, I hope you can handle things on your own. It's something you're going to have to get used to with the COI.
President Roosevelt had just authorized the formation of the COI that summer. They were supposed to be the outfit that handled the real spy stuff overseas. It was the place to be if you wanted real adventure. At least, that was the bill of goods the recruiters for the COI sold me. And here I was, stuck in a crummy old office, in Cleveland of all places, as far away from any real action as I could imagine. This might come in handy.
Yes?
Sorry to bother you, sir.
Not at all, Mr. Pearson. Come right in.
Sir, what happened to the fellow I'm replacing?
Walter Penske. Good man. And a good agent. Once. The job got the better of him.
I imagine he must have been under a lot of pressure, sir.
We all are these days. Just remember, Mr. Pearson, we follow orders, not personal crusades.
I will, sir. I have a question about this case file, sir.
Certainly. What is it?
Sir, this munitions owner, Mr. Finster, is there anything you can tell me about him that wasn't in the report?
Hank Finster is an interesting case. He's an important man with the fellows in the Defense Department on account of the munitions factories he owns. But he's not wound all too tight, if you catch my meaning. Well, it's always one thing after another with him. If it isn't the unions, it's the Reds. If it isn't the Reds, it's the Nazis. But he may have something there. Take a look at that invitation. What do you make of it?
Well, the invitation's a little unusual, but it looks like fascist propaganda to me.
And that it is, son. Now, I'm not saying it's Nazi propaganda. There are 100 different organizations with fascist agendas, but this call to brotherhood could have come straight out of Hitler's Germany. Did you notice the quality of the invitation itself? It's not a pamphlet or a flyer. Whoever these people are, they have a certain amount of sophistication. And they seem to be targeting only people of wealth and influence in our society. You'll need to be careful not to ruffle any feathers.
Yes, sir. Who handled this case when it first came in, sir?
A city detective named Marlowe. I guess he's got his hands full now. He's handling the torso murders investigation. Terrible work, that. They found another one just yesterday.
Tell me where Mr. Finster's office is.
He's up there. You're welcome.
Excuse me, Mr. Finster? Jim Pearson from the COI? Been assigned to investigate your complaint.
Ah, what the hell took you so long? I guess all my calls to Mayor Lausch finally got you guys off your cans.
What can you tell me about this brotherhood, Mr. Finster?
What can I tell you? Oh, what makes you think I can tell you anything? I'll tell you what it is, though. It's a Nazi conspiracy is what it is.
Now, what makes you say that, Mr. Finster? The invitation has no swastikas, no insignia, no clear-cut signs of Nazi involvement.
Now, you mark my words, young man. This is a Nazi conspiracy, or my name isn't Henry W. Finster.
I'm gonna need some hard facts before I'm able to make that stick with my superior, sir.
Where did they find you guys? Why don't they just pull you out of a pumpkin patch? It's right before your eyes. Those screwy symbols.
You recognize the symbols on that invitation?
I've seen them all over Germany.
When were you in Germany, Mr. Finster?
Don't you give me that look.
Mr. Finster, I...
There is nothing wrong with Germany. My grandparents were born in Deutschland. We still have family there. The German people are upstanding, hardworking, God-fearing folk. And the American workers. The only thing wrong with Germany is that Austrian peasant and his gang are street thugs.
My apologies, Mr. Finster. I am only trying to establish the facts in the case.
Okay. It's been 15, 20 years now since I've been here. But I will never forget those symbols.
Do you have any idea what those symbols mean?
Of course not. That would never have anything to do with that sort of thing.
What do you remember about the man that gave you that invitation, Mr. Finster?
He's a no-good bum, I remember that.
Do you remember his name?
I employed a Nazi sympathizer right here in my own factory.
He was an employee of yours?
Of course not. I don't hire Nazis.
I'm sorry. I'm a little confused. Who's the Nazi?
Why did they send a boy to do a man's job? What are they trying to do? Drive me crazy?
Wait just a minute, Mr. Finster. That's not called for.
My foreman, George Hansen. I used to think he was a good man. Well, he drinks a little bit too much, but he's a hard worker. Well, anyway, how am I supposed to know he traffics with Nazis? Well, he brings this riffraff right through my doors, into my factory, right into my office. He could have killed me. He was standing as close to me as you are right now. Well, naturally, I fired him on the spot.
Riffraff.
No, you idiot. George Hansen. Haven't you been listening to a word I said?
Do you remember the name of the man that gave you that invitation?
Of course not. He never mentioned it. He said he was just a messenger.
Can you describe this messenger for me?
I already described him to that detective. Look, I even picked his photograph out of one of their books. Oh, but he didn't care. All he was interested in was that vagrant killer. Well, if you ask me, he's doing this city a big favor.
I wouldn't know anything about that, sir. Can you describe him again for me, please, for my benefit?
You know, if you guys had done your work in the first place, you'd already know this. Yeah, he looked like a killer. Real mean, squinty eyes, red hair, and the bushiest red beard you'd ever want to see. Hey, there's no mistake in this guy.
Do you have any idea where I might be able to find this messenger?
Of course not.
Okay, what about this other fellow, the foreman?
Well, he used to live in company housing, but I had him evicted, of course.
You have any idea where I might be able to find him?
A man of my standing doesn't fraternize with his workers. Although, I have been told that George likes to throw his money around a lot on payday. The men, they like this cheap whiskey saloon in the Roaring Third. McGillies, McGarrity's, some kind of nickname. McGinty's, that's the name of it, McGinty's.
Come in.
Excuse me, Detective Merlo? I'm Jim Pearson. I'm from the COI. I'm here about Mr. Finster's complaint.
The what? This had better be good, kid. I'm up to my neck in murders.
Are you any closer to catching the torso killer?
That sick son of a bitch has been too clever.
How's that?
Well, for starters, he's not leaving enough behind for us to identify. Our best guess is he's cutting up bums and whores, people nobody'd miss. Takes them apart real clean, too, like a doctor. Two whacks and he's through them. The queerest thing is, he bleeds them dry, washes them clean, and wraps them up like a butcher, all nice and neat in newspapers. It's like nothing I've ever seen, and I've seen plenty.
Sure, it's only a matter of time before something breaks through.
Oh, you got that right. His kind always slips up. And when he does, bang, I'm gonna be right there on top of him.
Hasn't the FBI been able to give you any relief with the torso investigation?
That's a good one, kid. Elliot Ness has saddled me with a junior AG man named Winslow, who doesn't know his ass from a hole in the ground. About all he's done is look pretty in his fancy suits for the photo boys and flapped his gums to the reporters about how he is gonna catch that killer.
You were the detective that handled Mr. Finster's complaint?
Finster? Oh yeah, Finster. I remember him now. Listen, kid. If I had a nickel for every so-called Nazi spy in this city, I would be a very rich man.
So you don't think his complaint was legitimate?
Ever since you secret agent types start stirring people up about Nazi spies, every Tom, Dick, and Harry with a beef about his neighbors has been into my office. You care to take a guess how many of them panned out?
Well, what did your investigation reveal? Was there anything to the invitation? You did investigate this, didn't you?
Now listen, Sonny! There's a butcher on the loose in my city! I didn't have time! Hey, isn't that sort of thing your job now? I don't have time to babysit another fed.
Detective, I understand you must be very busy right now.
You don't understand nothing! Every day, it seems, we find another body or a part of a body. We don't have enough good leads and we don't have enough men to cover this case. And on top of that, I got some horse's ass from the Federal Bureau of Investigation looking over my shoulder trying to tell me how to do my job.
I'm sorry to have bothered you, Detective. I'll be on my way.
This case is gonna be the death of me, Ed. For what it's worth, kid, Finster had a look at the mugshot, folks. He said he spotted the Joe what handed him that screwy invitation. I think he even marked the books and everything. You can have a look through them if you think it'll help.
Thank you, Detective. This must be the one Finster looked through.
And now for the day's news. Our top story today comes straight from the tough and tumble neighborhood of Kingsbury Run. There, the police continue their exhaustive manhunt for the torso killer. As his head count hits 7, the citizens of Cleveland raise their voices in protest. Meanwhile, the city police have been baffled by this insidious madman's terrible work. The latest victim, discovered by 2 children playing along the banks of the Cuyahoga River, remains unidentified. Meanwhile, in news from around the world, our boys at sea captured an Axis ship in equatorial waters. The Axis vessel unsuccessfully attempted a nefarious ploy to bluff its way through the British blockade. Our sources indicate the Axis boat falsely flaunted our very own stars and stripes and had an American name painted on her pilot house and stern in an attempt to pass itself off as one of our own. Our American cruiser's good commander was too smart to fall for such a trick, however, and he immediately ordered the ship to heave to. Despite a last-ditch effort by the Axis merchantmen to blow up their own ship, their vessel was captured without incident. In other global news...
Excuse me, I'm looking for a man named George Hansen. He used to be...
I never heard of him.
Listen, buddy, I'm not trying to cause any trouble for you. I just need a little help trying to find a friend of mine.
Yeah, friend, huh? Look, I got nothing to do with no lousy feds. Why don't you do me a favor and scram, huh? While you're at it, take that friend over there with you. Disguised as a Dutch scaring away all my business.
I guess our mates down under could use a few lessons from our own boys at sea. In Washington today, Subaru Kurusu, Japan's new and super special envoy to the United States, is set to begin a round of talks with the State Department. These talks come right on the heels of Tojo's stinging remarks regarding Roosevelt's Pacific policy.
Who wants to know?
My name's Jim Pearson. I'm from the COI.
Breaking point, officials in Washington.
Well, have a seat, Jimbo.
Japan's pinch hitter on the diplomatic diamond can head off.
The name's Winslow. Confrontation. Dick Winslow.
Also in nice to meet you, Mr. Winslow. What brings you here?
Oh, no need to be so formal. You can call me Dick.
Interventionist Continental Congress for Freedom displayed surprising.
I'm just here for a drink.
The newspaper Head Honchos
really?
Reported that their communities were now overwhelmingly.
This just doesn't seem like your type of place.
No, why not? Why can't a working Joe like me go out for a drink? Can't he try someplace new?
Well, you just seem a little overdressed, is all. Exists only in the
minds of congressmen who have guilty as charged, sport. Of a great surge of not a bad bit of deduction, that. Recent months. Oh, well, I might as well confess,
in
you're right.
National news, hopes ran high that John L. Lewis
with the
will
FBI.
Call an end to the coal mine strike.
Really?
After 12 striking miners.
What are you doing here?
During riots.
Staking the place out.
New York has
I thought I might get a lead on the torso Jerry killer, but I haven't had much luck yet.
Tali's barking awoke 16 families residing in apartments.
But you're new here, aren't you?
Yeah, I just started.
Oh, you don't say.
Our dog hero
and,
gave his
what brings
life,
you here
however,
to McGinty's, Jimbo?
Well, I'm working on an investigation of my own.
Jerry left oh, really? How interesting.
And collapsed.
Did someone steal some plans for a secret
doctor,
weapon?
Jerry
huh?
Was
or commit an act of sabotage, perhaps?
No, nothing like that. I'm looking into a group
in
of possible
news,
German subversives.
Well, perhaps your men are on our little German blacklist.
Meanwhile, here in our
you mean they haven't
Beloved
told
City,
you about that?
An estimated crowd of
your office should have a copy.
For the Freedom Day
really?
Rally at
I'd complain
Hall.
To my superiors right away.
The cheering
how can a new agent hope
Freedom
to succeed without the necessary tools?
What is this list?
And call for an end
it's a list
to
of suspicious Americans of German descent.
Weather,
FBI has been keeping tabs on them for a while now. Oh, it wouldn't take much
and
for some of them to sell out Uncle Sam
today,
for a
the Barons extend
Uncle
their
Adolf, huh?
Thanks for the information, Dick. This list might come in handy. Well, I should be going now.
Listen,
unconfirmed
sport.
Reports from Indians management
you're new here,
that
so I'll give you one little bit of free advice. Some of the people in your department have stepped on some toes, so
to
be careful where you put your foot
boys.
Down.
I'll remember that.
A deal goes through,
well, it was a pleasure to meet you, Jimbo.
The youngest man
drop by my office anytime.
Thanks, Dick.
Club.
I just may take you up on that.
We now return you to the magical melodies of Mel Fritz.
Yes.
Sorry to bother you, sir.
Not at all, Mr. Pearson. Come right in.
Sir, is it true that the FBI's made a list of suspicious German Americans?
Who have you been talking to?
Special Agent Winslow, sir.
Oh, yes, Agent Winslow. It's true, we do have such a list. When France fell to the Germans, a lot of people felt that it must be due to the work of a fifth column of spies and traitors. It got the boys in Washington thinking that if we weren't careful, things might happen the same way here. And, well, Mr. Hoover and his FBI set to work, watching anyone they felt could betray their own countrymen. Naturally, important Americans of German descent were watched most closely.
Could I get a look at it, sir? I believe there might be a connection between some of the names on that list and the case that I'm investigating.
Just remember, son, it's possible that any of these men on that list are hard-working Americans, no different than you or I. Don't go off all half-cocked simply because Hoover's men put a name on a list.
Yes, sir. When I arrived back at my office, there was another message from the museum. Whatever had been going on between Walter Pensky and Dr. Strauss seemed to be pretty important to both of them. Since I didn't have any more leads on my own investigation, and since Strauss's name did appear on the FBI's blacklist, along with Hank Finster's, I thought I might as well check into it.
Strauss?
I'm Helen Strauss.
Hi, how do you do? I'm
Jim Pearson from the COI. I came across your name at work, and I was hoping, I was hoping you might be able to help me.
I'd love to. That is, if I can.
What is it exactly your father does, Helen?
Why? Didn't Mr. Pensky tell you?
I'm afraid I've never met Mr. Penske.
But don't you... I'm afraid I don't understand. Didn't Mr. Penske send you?
I've replaced Mr. Penske. I found the message you left for him, and, well, I was hoping you might be able to tell me what he needed to see your father about.
He wanted my father to examine some artifacts he'd found on an investigation of his. As far as I know, they never did meet. My father was called away suddenly on business, and I didn't want to leave Mr. Penske in the lurch. That's why I volunteered to help. If I could, of course.
What is it you do here, Helen?
Well, I'm just a graduate student intern here now, but one day I'm going to run this museum, or one just like it anyway. They've got such a wonderful display of Central European artifacts from the Middle Ages. Well, that's my area of study, Central European history, and I'm sorry. I'm sure you're not interested in listening to me babble. I could so just go on and on about my work.
That's okay, Professor.
My father's the professor.
And I just bet you're a chip off the old block. What do you make of this?
I don't think I've ever heard of the Brotherhood of Thule before. I do seem to recall a group called the Thule Society, however. They were a secret society that became very popular with the German people after the Great War. Some people said they were a cabal of black magicians.
Black magicians? You don't really believe that, do you?
No, it's far more likely they met as an excuse to drink beer and talk about politics. They did have a great deal of influence on the German people, however. They were early proponents of German nationalism and Aryan superiority. And without the backing of the Thule Society, the Nazi Party probably would never have lasted.
Yeah, wouldn't that have been a shame? What do you make of those symbols?
These are runes, and that's their English translation beneath them. These crests are what really interests me. They're not the crests of traditional German aristocracy. Wait a minute.
What is it, Helen?
I know where I've seen these before.
What are you looking for?
Aha! These are the crests of an ancient sect of Germanic knights. They posed as Christian soldiers. They still continue to worship the old Norse gods and gave human sacrifices to them. Eventually, they were excommunicated by the Pope and forced into exile from Germany.
I don't get it. So, how is it you know so much about these pagan knights?
Well, I should know they're one of my father's pet projects. He's in the process of restoring a stained glass window with the crest of the officers of the sect even now.
And I don't get it. What do those knights have to do with this invitation?
Well, they're the same. The crests are the same.
So, whoever these people are, this Brotherhood of Thule, they're modeling themselves after an ancient sect of pagan knights here in Cleveland?
It sure seems that way.